Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on Fat Burning Man, where we talk about how to avoid becoming the Borg. Have you ever measured the dirty electricity and electromagnetic pollution emanating from your smart devices at all times? You don't need me to tell you that modern humans are tethered to technology to an astonishing degree, but for unspecified reasons, electromagnetic frequencies, or EMFs, and the many health issues that they create are too often hidden from the conversation. Do you keep your phone in your pocket or use your laptop on your lap? We are the first humans ever to microwave our nether regions on a daily basis. That is no bueno. So, what effects do EMFs really have on our bodies? The answer will raise a few eyebrows. We have the perfect guest for you today. We're here with Justin Frandson, an author and athleticism performance coach who has worked with amateur and professional athletes for over two decades. After watching his athletes' health break down, Justin began to test clients in their homes for dirty technology and now works to help reduce EMF pollution for optimal health. If you use a phone, have a Wi-Fi router in your house, or any smart devices whatsoever, you'll want to listen to this show. Before we get there, here's a quick plug to encourage you to join us in our next wild challenge. To help give you some extra motivation to reach your health goals, we're doing a big wild challenge for the new year with customizable goals, done-for-you meal plans, colorful tracking tools, and community support. It's really been a lot of fun to host these challenges over the years, and of course, we couldn't do any of this without you folks joining in. And over the years, we've made improvements to our systems and the ability to collaborate and work with you and help coach you toward better health. And now we have a brand spanking new, awesome, updated app that helps guide the challenges as we do them. And good news to our international friends, our new Wild Challenge app is available worldwide on Google Play and the App Store. So far, we've had thousands of people who have joined the Wild Challenge from around the world, including the US, Canada, Italy, the UK, and more. So if you need a little help shedding that spare tire or cleaning up your diet this year, or if you just want to benefit from tracking your daily meals, movement, meditation, things like that, right now you can join us in the Wild Challenge by going to fatburningman.com/app. Since you're a fan of the Fat Burning Man podcast and you're listening right now, let's give you a special promo code to save you 25% off. All you have to do is enter WILD25 in the promo code box at checkout. That's WILD25 in the promo box. All of a sudden, you'll get 25% off. You'll be entered into our next giveaway, and you get to join us in this awesome challenge that we have coming up. So I can't wait to see you there. One more time, it's fatburningman.com/app, and the promo code is WILD25. All right, on to the show with Justin Frandson. We're talking about surprising ways artificial EMFs impact our health and what to do about it, tips for minimizing dirty electricity in your home, invisible stressors contributing to low testosterone and infertility, the dangers of high-tech green energy, why you should never put your laptop on your lap, easy ways to save cell phone battery and avoid surveillance marketing at the same time, and tons more. Very quickly, before we get to the interview, you may notice that on this interview series and on this show, sometimes we're talking on one side of an issue and other times we're talking on the other. You know, all about tracking and using these smart devices to make sure that you can measure your sleep and look at where you're at and what your heart rate's doing and your blood sugar. And then on the other side, just being barefoot in nature, being completely away from technology. And the answer is somewhere in the middle. I've got my smart ring on right now. It's tracking my sleep, my movement, my steps when I go out for a run, how often I'm breathing, how well I'm sleeping, and how often I'm waking up, all that stuff. I have a continuous glucose monitor plugged into my arm right now. I wear a GPS watch when I go out for my long runs and adventures and things like that. But all of those things are used temporarily to gather data or to do experiments. And as soon as I'm done with them and want to kind of regain my health and happiness, I tend to be more the barefoot in the woods type. And so keep in mind that you don't have to choose one or the other and be permanently on one side tracking yourself all the time, or be permanently on the other side just barefoot in the woods lost somewhere. We can kind of shift back and forth, and I think that will serve our health very well. But I think you'll be surprised by what Justin has to say about how damaging a lot of these new smart trackers and smart devices are, even if they're marketed for health. So, all of that said, I hope you enjoy this interview with Justin. It's a good one. Welcome back, folks. Today we're here with Justin Frandson, an author and athleticism performance coach who has worked with amateur and professional athletes for over two decades. After watching his athletes break down from excessive EMFs, Justin began testing clients in homes and now works to help reduce EMF pollution for optimal health. Thanks so much for joining us today, Justin.
Abel, thanks so much for having me on. Appreciate it.
So let's start generally, because it seems that EMFs are buried or hidden from the conversation. It's not something that a lot of people are totally into, although you find pretty much all of us, kids and adults alike, on technology more than ever, around technology more than ever. And so let's start with just a general overview of why that's not always a good thing.
Well, man-made EMF is what we're really interested in looking at. EMF is electromagnetic field or frequency, and it can be a man-made, which is a one-directional waveform, and it wouldn't work if it weren't one-directional. Or it can be the way the universe is made and the way we're made with EMF. We're all electromagnetic beings, but we do really well with waveforms that distribute equally in every direction, that are unpolarized. So it's the polar opposite of what the man-made is. So that's a real true difference right there. And then with that difference, there's just a long list of things that really are challenging for our body to assimilate from that.
And what we're talking about in terms of EMFs, these frequencies are different from what would be emanated from the sun or from Mother Nature. It's fundamentally a different thing. So let's dig a little deeper there and talk about how it's different and why our physiology is challenged by this and needs to adapt in kind of a different way than getting in sync with nature's patterns.
You got it. Let's go into how the universe is made. The universe and us are all one. We are one with nature. We are one with the universe. And we do really well with unpolarized waveforms. If the sun were a one-directional beam, Abel, we wouldn't be here. It would kill us instantly. But that's the way this man-made stuff is made. It's made in one-directional. And it's a polarizing charge for our body. And it's 10 zeros faster of a polarizing one-directional waveform than we're ever used to. So the Schumann resonance of the Earth, the healing pulse of the Earth, is measured to be about 7.83 hertz or waves per second. And our bodies, when we're sleeping, we're 1 to 8 or below 1 hertz or waves per second. So that would be a theta or a delta brainwave state. When we're in a theta state, you're 4 to 8 hertz or waves per second. So we really recover and do so optimally when we're in that lower wavelength state. And EMFs are measured in the speed of a wavelength. And I'm going to break it down and characterize it as waves per second so that everyone can understand it versus getting too technical on the terms. Well, this phone right here, when it's working Wi-Fi on, cellular on, Bluetooth on, just one of those is 2.45 billion waves per second. Then you start to add the Wi-Fi and you add the Bluetooth. So we're looking at just a cell phone in the billions of waves per second when we sleep at 1 or below 1 to 8 waves per second. And then for athletes, I work with lots of athletes, athleticism.com. I'm a performance coach. I do nerve work for sports performance for many years. And when my athletes are at optimal performance, they're in the alpha state. They're in the 8 to 12 hertz or waves per second. That's their brainwave state, really slow. But that's when they're in the flow. We call it the infinite flow of the universe. When they're in the zone where they can't miss their shot, and they're just so fluid, that's what we love watching and marvel at their coordination. But that's a brainwave state and the speed of the wavelengths that they're at. So this 5G rollout, Abel, we're looking at 50 are actually 60 to 90 billion waves per second. So it's a huge difference. And then when you add 10 zeros to the speed of a wavelength, you know, that's a polar opposite charge than where we're charged. It's a huge difference to anyone's body. And then especially convert it to dollars and you add 10 zeros to a bank account, that's a massive difference for the body. So just physiologically, like, that is how the universe works. It's all waveforms and resonances. And I want to be clear that even if it is a cosmic shift in the atmosphere, that can be disruptive for our bodies, and our bodies will adapt. And we saw that before 1918, like everyone, you know, in each shift where a lot of people got sick at one time was because they were adapting to electromagnetic shifts in the cosmic field. Because remember, our environment is ether and plasma, and these waveforms travel through that. And that's how you're in Colorado, I'm in Southern California. That's how we're communicating. It's all through waveform and how our universe is made. But if we, and it's not far off to understand that if there's a shift in our electromagnetic blanket with millimeter waves traveling billions of waves per second, that it can communicate instantly across the world and affect everyone at one point in time.
And these frequencies and their effects on our physiology are known to the military, not just known, but known as weapons in a lot of cases. So why is there such a blind eye there to that whole side of the conversation where it's just like, well, it's unprecedented to be around this sort of radiation. That is known, but it's also known that it's a bit more damaging than that. So maybe you could go a bit deeper there as well.
I know you're big in the health space and obviously in the food space, and that was what where I heard you years ago. And we've been tricked in a lot of these industries, and not just tricked, but told lies, and really need to unlearn what they've told us loud for a very long time, which isn't really the truth. And it's really true in the agricultural and the food industry, in telecom industry, in the pharmaceutical industry. There's industries that are informing us of the information they want us to believe. And they do it really loud and for a really long time. And that's why this stuff has been able to stay the way it stayed. It's for profit for industries. And in 1996, our government set procedural levels of EMF. And they said, if something's ionizing, then that's where we draw the line, because it causes a thermal effect like a millimeter wave would do in a microwave, where it oscillates the cells and warms it up. And if it's non-ionizing, then it's okay for our body. But these studies from Dr. Martin Paul at Washington State University and bioinitiative.org with 200 scientists from over 40 countries, we've unraveled so much more in this period of time that we know that even if it's low level EMF, there's still a vibration, and still that vibration is what is a secondary effect on our body, which opens up the voltage gated calcium channels and allows positive calcium into a negative cell that in turn causes tremendous cell and DNA damage. And so that's what our bodies are seeing and feeling. It's this vibration effect. And unfortunately, our governments are saying, hey, that's not really true. Then they've touted that for the last, you know, 20 some years as being true. And the FCC isn't, and they're not a health industry. And even if they were a government health industry, they still don't care about our health. But especially that FCC does not care about our health. They want connectivity. And that's why you're in a remote area in Colorado. I mean, their narrative, Abel, is to say, hey, let's give the whole world Wi-Fi and be connected. Well, when you go to most remote areas, there's no electricity there. It's just nature. When you go to a third world country that's poverty-ridden, there's absolutely no electricity there. So what in the world are they going to do with Wi-Fi beaming down on them, or phased array beams coming down from above, radiating them? All it does is it's an environmental toxin and a biotoxin that is making us sick. And that's what we're seeing the last few years, is we're adapting to this toxin.
Eesh. That's such a grim way of looking at it. What does it turn us into if we keep adapting in that direction? Have you wondered? The dystopian fantasy version? Do we become the Borg? Or let's talk first. Yeah, go ahead.
I don't want to get too fear-ridden, because there's a cool thing called physics where we can convert a waveform from one directional into something that our body accepts and distributes equally. But I do know that the studies are showing that several generations out, people will be infertile. And this is the biggest challenge, is a lack of fertility right now that we're seeing for the future generations, for sure.
And that definitely has major implications, as much as people want to not talk about, you know, problems with testosterone, problems with fertility, problems with other conditions that are widespread and widely known as becoming more and more just around us and accepted as normal, yet it shouldn't be. So what can we do to mitigate some of these effects, or at least test for them? Let me just share one thing real quick. We do have some EMF meters that we've had for a few years, and I have noticed a trend in all of our devices as we upgrade over the years. Most of our stuff is from like between 2014 and 2018, maybe 2019, but even during that time, we've seen an exponential increase in the amount of EMFs that are coming out of those devices, even the amount of kind of thermal load on your lap from some of these new Apple laptops and the M1 chips and all the rest of this stuff. But it's not going down. It's not being mitigated. If anything, it's getting much, much worse, and probably exponentially so, it seems.
Yeah, it is. The amount of electrification from man-made is been exponentially prolific, and it keeps going and going and going. Arthur Furstenberg really wrote in his book, I forget the levels that he stated, which are dauntingly high. And he wrote a book called The Invisible Rainbow, which I recommend everyone pick up and look at. This is what it looks like. Have you read that, Abel, or seen it?
I think I came across it years ago, but I haven't in a long time, if I have at all.
So that one's a great one to showcase it. I have doctors that saying that there were levels at 50 times 5G right now with the Internet of Things, with the smart meters, with the cell sites, with the satellites beaming down. We're looking at levels that are unprecedented, that our bodies are never seen. And we're so resilient. The challenge is everyone bends and breaks at different levels. And depending on how strong our life force is, depending on how good they are with their food and their intake and living a clean lifestyle. So that's where it's been really challenging, is for the government to go, aha, it's the EMF that caused that. Well, it causes so many, like literally so many things, that they've used that to not show that it affects us. But it really does in so many different ways. And I think going back to the testosterone that you mentioned, I had a colleague that was working exclusively with athletes, and he got hired by the military to go in with special forces and do blood work. And all he does is blood work. That's all he does. And make sure you're eating the right food, have the right nutrition, all the challenges out of you. He threw in a variable of guys driving electric cars, guys and gals driving electric cars. It was the biggest marker change of 18% lower testosterone.
Wow. And,
I mean, I don't know about you, but in no health books over my entire career have I ever seen sitting on a massive battery is good for your health. But yet here we are rolling it out and thinking that electric cars are great for us. And hey, it's the future. But we don't realize cadmium, we still mine precious minerals. We're still mining coal. You know, the whole thing has to... it has a shelf life, and then you're filling up our landfills with acid, with dead batteries, But the whole time we're sitting on a massive battery, which equates to dirty electricity, that static and sparking. That's a really challenging vibration for our body. Dirty electricity is known to be one of the trickiest parts of the EMF wavelength spectrum, 50 to 60 waves. No, that 50, 60 is milligauss. And then you go into about 100,000 waves per second, you get into the dirty spectrum lane. And then the wireless, it will be in the millions to billions of waves per second range. But that 100,000 range with that, where there's static and sparking in the line, trying to get the level of acceleration that you're looking for, there's a huge vibration and static in that. And that's, you know, detrimental to our body.
So we hear all this conversation about, you know, green energy. I remember getting really into it actually when I was in college and right out of college. You know, I graduated in 2006 and took a job in consulting and worked in green energy and alternative energy and looked into carbon credits and all this ridiculous stuff. And I'm just like, this story is becoming very, very twisted very quickly. And when you look at green energy today and kind of how that's playing out, we've had an off-grid RV for 6+ years now. And so we've gone through a number of dirty batteries and created so much waste. And I'm wondering what's going to happen to the solar panels when they expire. And they were, like you said, definitely mined and created somewhere. And that's not free. I remember right around those years when I was getting into green energy, I got an old Mercedes diesel for like $2,500 and ran it on biodiesel. I learned how to kind of filter the oil and get old fryolator oil and stuff like that using an old waste oil. And I'm like, that's green energy. That sounds like fun. But they kind of shut all that stuff down, especially using waste oils as fuel. But and now it's all about kind of this high tech green energy. And a whole part of the conversation that's missing is what are the implications on our physiology, on our bodies, on our long-term health from sitting on this giant battery that can go way faster than is ever necessary for anyone to ever go, but not really that far. They're power hungry. So it just makes the problem worse and worse. And you can't power them with solar panels in the way that a lot of people were thinking of in the 80s or the 90s or the 2000s when all this stuff was kind of trotted out as the promise of the future.
Yeah. And to second that, Abel, when you use gasoline, your vehicle becomes lighter. As you use electricity, it weighs the same. So you go in and you have less fuel with electricity at the end, but you're not being more efficient in any way, shape, or form. And then you have to recharge it and use electricity to recharge it. And then the watts for, let's say it's a cell tower, the amount of wattage used to power these is super high. And so we're actually upping the electrical grid that we've wanted to lower. And right. So I don't understand how that didn't make sense to someone right out of the gates. But again, it's like, hey, why is this help? Why is a mask help? Well, it's not. There's no way, shape, or form that putting your body in a sympathetic nervous system and giving you 3% oxygen, less oxygen, is healthy for you. So we've been really tricked and need to unlearn what we've learned in all the industries, which is really unfortunate.
Just on that point, maybe you'll have a unique take on this because you've been in the world of athleticism for a long time. But before I moved to Colorado, I was really interested in kind of the times that I've visited high elevation places, the opportunity for improving the way that your body performs. It's terrible at first, but then, you know, you kind of get used to it, you adapt. But the best way to do that is moving up to elevation, but other ways include wearing masks, which limit the amount of oxygen that come, you know, through your nose and your mouth. And I had one of these masks and I used it for a while and hated it. I hated it so much. I'm sure you've tried so many different pieces of exercise gear over the year, but I hated that so much that I literally moved to Colorado instead, pretty much. Because this is way better, at least temporarily. But so maybe you can just riff on the, this is a known fact that wearing masks, especially when you are exercising, is something that does achieve an end, but it might not be the end that you want.
Well, the whole mask thing is really challenging for me because it's so devastating for a lot of ways. It's for child development, seeing facial recognition. It shuts down your oxygen, as I mentioned, 3%. It puts your body in a sympathetic nervous system mode. Sizes, if it's used, if they are touting it, used it for a virus, they say that it's not even effective for smoke of a fire. But a virus, the size of a virus is way smaller than the particles of a smoke. So it doesn't work for either. So, and then if it's made in a toxic environment, you're breathing in toxicity, you know, through that and lots of chemicals through it. And then there's just no reason for it, number one. And it's never been health, touted as health. I think they use it in operating so stuff doesn't fall into a patient per se. But it's not to prevent a spread of anything per se. To go back into the EMF stuff, and I look back, I see you're a musician, and I wanted to mention Eddie Van Halen. Do you remember he passed a couple years ago?
Sure.
And there was an article that he came out, and yeah, he partied a lot, and he died of cancer, and he had it in his throat or tongue. I forget what it was specifically. But what he said in one of the articles is he touted that he always played with a copper pick and he had two picks and he had one in his hand and one in his mouth. And he would play hours, 8 hours a day with a pick, a copper pick in his mouth with electrical instruments all around him and him holding them. And he feels that the reason he got cancer in his mouth was from the EMF and having a conductor directly in his mouth.
Yikes. Well, you know, musicians do talk about different electrical frequencies, dirty electricity, the infamous brown note and other things like that. But the especially dirty electricity in amplifiers and playing guitar with old tube amps and things like that, you can hear how dirty a lot of our electricity is. You can tell that certain outlets weren't wired right. I've been shocked in the mouth while singing by microphones. You know, it's just like this stuff is really gnarly. And you can kill yourself too, especially if there's a little short somewhere or if a wire's been chewed up by some, you know, animal or something. It's definitely a dangerous part of performing live sound. But the thing that makes it so visceral, at least for me, is hearing how bad it can be, even in really expensive houses. Really, really wonderful performance venues can sometimes be beaming all sorts of radiation out there. The amount of Wi-Fi signals that your device can pick up in the several hundreds is also going through your body and all of our bodies at all times. And so let's talk about Wi-Fi and routers and placement of all this within your own life in your house or where to put things in your pocket or not. But generally speaking, correct me if I'm wrong, you want a bit of distance between you and these devices, or at least a buffer in between you and these devices, right?
Definitely. They have a SARS rating, which is the absorption rating. And when a cell phone manufacturer makes a phone, they never test it right on your face. They test it away from you. And we're supposed to have the further away, the way less damaging it is for your body. And the more our body will be able to assimilate it. But remember, like a fetus, they don't have a skull or a blood-brain barrier. They don't have any defense mechanism. So women in the first trimester, just holding a cell phone, you're cooking your fetus, your baby. And so, and then the elderly, they don't have as much chi or life force, so they're gonna get hit a lot harder. And until we're 24, our skulls aren't fully developed. So there's this time in youth and elderly where the proximity awareness to this stuff is so, so important. I took an internship when I was in college, and I was circling a copy machine for this guy, for these guys, for weeks on end. I was pulling paper right off their X-ray machine. This is radiation right off the copy machine. That's radiation. I developed sensitivity nerve challenges in my fingertips from that job of pulling papers off the copy machine. Now, when I go to use a touch screen phone, I have nerve pain. It's like acute pain when I go to touch it. So I have to use a stylus. I mean, I have to, because I have nerve pain. So I feel the next generations when they're on these things for 20 years, by the time they're 40-ish, they're going to have some nerve sensitivities as well, because this stuff chips away at our life force. So it's really important to understand first, Abel, what the stressors are, and then grab a meter and meter them. That's the best way to identify them. And we categorize them into milligauss, which is electricity or magnetic resonances. And then we categorize it into dirty electricity, which we can use a Stetzer electric meter, S-T-E-T-Z-E-R, electric.com meter. You plug in the wall, and that tells the amps to volts and any static in the line. And then we use an acoustometer, which is a wireless, like a radio frequency meter, to measure the millimeter waves, all the wireless waveforms. So you can understand what they are and then how to measure them. And then once you do that, then you could see it. Like, hey, when we point an acoustometer up to my phone, it's a great example for a kid who thinks this is harmless and something so, you know, great that they're just buried with poor posture in it all day, night. That thing starts screaming, just screaming. The meter will just go off the charts when you have a one-directional acoustometer, radio frequency meter. It meters out. Like, the meter can't meter the amount of levels that phone is outputting. It's not strong enough, which is wild. I find wild, because how do we know that the telecom is broadcasting 4G or 5G? We don't know. There's no meter to meter the level of a cell phone. So I, to my furthest imagination, I can't even fathom how our government could say, hey, telecom, you're in charge of our health and what levels you're leveling at, because there's no meter that we can even validate what you're saying. And it is weaponry. I work with SEALs. You see the Ford, and I still have to get you a few things, a care package. But the Ford in my book is written by a 20-year retired Navy SEAL. And I work with military, and all these guys have all confirmed this is weaponry we're rolling out. So how do we even trust the fact that it's not damaging for us when they can use it as crowd control and a lot of other things? But let's go back to the home. What we want to understand is their electricity from any of the outlets, anything you plug in the wall, that will kick off a resonance in a lower bandwidth, low level EMF. Then we go into the dirty electricity, which would be dim switches on your lights, trying to keep the level of light that you're requesting. Solar panels on a home. That is, again, storing it and then giving you the level that you're requesting. That's dirty electricity. Every home that I've metered hundreds of homes, will end up having really high dirty electricity. Every single one of them. And then you go into the wireless. Well, let's go back to dirty electricity. Dirty electricity can also be from your improper wiring. So signals going in and out of a junction or transformer have to meet. And that's how we ground out. That's how electricity can be healthy for us. A lot of this is really a manufacturing error and lack of diligence. And they really are cutting corners, I think, for profit and not caring about our health. But thanks to people like you that are allowing us to share this message with a grand audience, people are becoming more aware that, hey, this needs to be ground out properly and wired properly. And Dave Stetzer will say most of the electrical challenges are from improper manufacturing. So when you also see rats eating lines going in and out of a transformer junction below ground, you'll see really high levels of dirty electricity in the homes around it. And then you go into the wireless, and that will be any wireless device, cell phone, routers, smart meters, which is your automated gas and electric meter, Alexas, Nest AC units, your Ring doorbells, your smart TVs, the literally wearable technology, earbuds, remote like Bluetooth from, so you have a mouse that's not corded in. All these are wireless signals that are chipping away at your health. They're saying, talk to me, talk to me. They're always looking for you to communicate with it. They're sending out that those billions of waves per second all the time, ready to answer whatever question you're going to ask it. But what happens is that's not a great recipe for our health over an extended period of time. And it's definitely not a great recipe for health when we're wanting to sleep and go into a deeper REM sleep of the theta or a delta brainwave state, where we get that deep restorative sleep, because your brain wants to figure out what's pinging it and goes into these twilight sleeps.
So really having the router be shut off or unplugging it or getting away from it at night, if you can, is a really good idea and pretty low tech and low cost most of the time, right?
Oh, definitely. I mean, there's so many solutions, Abel, that we can go through. And now that we have an understanding of what the different types are, how we can meter them, now we can identify them and go, hey, let's establish these proximity protocols of turning your router, putting your router on a timer so it definitely goes off at night when you're sleeping. Some people even can hardwire, and they don't even need the router. They can hardwire fiber optic Ethernet cables like directly into their home. So they are corded directly into their phone or computer through hardwiring, which is optimal. And that's what I have on my computer. I'm hardwired. So my router in my office is hundreds of feet from me. Like, it's not close to me. So that's what we want. We don't want it right under your desk where your private parts are. We don't want it in your bedroom where you're wanting to sleep. So we can learn how to hardwire these things that fiber optic's faster. It's safer security-wise. You can't hack into that bandwidth. And then it's more reliable, and there's minimal health challenges from it. So I marvel at how we've gone away from wiring stuff out of looking cool or convenience, when there's four substantial reasons why we shouldn't have gone away from it, especially for kids in schools, and especially for us. And so anyhow, those are some of the things. So never put laptops on your lap. Make sure, a lot of people will go to the extent, like I have in my home, our electricity goes off in all of our bedrooms at night. So literally there is zero electricity in the bedroom at night. Make sure your room you want more incandescent lights. The new LED lights have transformers in them. That will cause lots of dirty electricity as well. So I see these brand new beautiful homes. They don't need as many light sockets, but the electricians sell them on extra lights. So it's lit up like a Christmas tree, and they all have transformers. And the thing is just having the highest level of dirty electricity that the home's ever seen. And they're like, wait, we wanted a new home and a green home. And yet it's not, because of the lighting in the home. So check your wiring. Make sure you have some proximity from transformers. If it's an older transformer, convert it to a newer one. Sometimes the lines above ground are healthier because you can see if they're not ground, if they're sparking static in it, versus stuff underneath the ground where you have to look for flickering in your lights. A lot of different things to be aware of. I would get rid of all corded phones, or actually all phones that aren't corded in, cordless phones, and because you don't need them. And if you do, just plug it in when you go to use it. Get rid of all the Alexas. They're just listening to you, and they're doing what we call basically They're doing surveillance marketing mechanisms where they're listening to what you're saying, and then they're marketing to you through that. And I believe that there's even more AI with ulterior motives. Yeah, and every app on your phone has about 1 to 12 trackers or more that listen to your everything. They know your fingerprints, your retina scan, your gait, how well you sleep, how fast you drive, all your bank account information, all your passwords. They know everything about you. And that's all handled in the CCP district, which is really challenging. So potentially that's a huge security and privacy threat for ourselves. Opt out of your smart meter. Josh Del Sol, one of my friends, did a documentary movie called Take Back Your Power. And if you haven't seen it, I highly recommend it. One of the best documentary movies on smart meters and opting out of those smart meters, because you never want your head on the other side of a refrigerator. You never want your head or your bed on the other side of a smart meter. And you can use repelling devices to send the signals different way, paint, Faraday bags or anything shielding. Obviously, we use our grounding bags to convert the waveforms to help people sleep and repel EMF. So we look to nature to solve the challenge of coexisting with this stuff. And then really make sure, I think the big thing is make sure everyone gets grounded by nature and gets outside and goes barefoot.
You said so many important things there, but one that stood out to me is that we just don't need a lot of this, right? Like having a wire, I've never really worried about having this mouse wired into my computer compared to a wireless mouse. Like it really isn't solving many problems for us. Being able to talk on the phone, you know what? I miss those phones that you could slam down and curl your finger around, you know, the ones that were, they were sturdy. They lasted for years. They weren't blasting your head with radiation, which we know causes all sorts of negative health effects and impacts our mood, our anxiety, all these things that are traced to poor sleep, depression, and all these other things in many ways are affected in a negative way by all of this new technology that's around us. I know that we feel a heck of a lot better when we're out in rural locations, out in nature, like you said, compared to being in the middle of some city where you're being beamed with those hundreds of different Wi-Fi and microwave towers and all sorts of just crap that, once again, we don't really need. You watch these movies from 20 or 30 years ago, and it's like, man, that's so nice that no phones are going off and they're not carrying them around. It's like they had this all figured out before. And also, sometimes not having technology is a luxury, right? People don't generally see it that way because you're not consuming as much or spending as much money or having flashy things around. But it's a real luxury to not have these things bombarding you all the time.
Yeah. And I would even go into, well, I agree with that. And then I would also say electricity is a luxury.
And well, absolutely. Yeah. And fair enough.
We don't need that to live. Like we've gone into this place where it's use and ease, and yeah, we have refrigeration. There's some great benefits from it, but man, you put a candle on in a dark room at night and it lights up the whole room. Like we don't need to have 15 LED lights lighting up your whole living room at all. So yeah, we want to go into that for sure. I mean, there's so much to unravel in that. I think diving into some of the challenges, like how do we know this stuff affects us? Well, we know Martin Paul's work of voltage-gated calcium channels causes tremendous cell and DNA damage. We know Dr. Klinghart's work, mold, mycotoxin, parasites, Lyme, they're all charged by EMF. So anyone unraveling those health challenges, get grounded by nature, go outside, get in the ocean, any body of water, do a picnic out on the lawn, get barefoot. If you can't get barefoot, touch a tree, just get grounded. I think subconsciously, like we can have that intent to ground ourselves and we can get grounded, just body, mind, spirit, connect to Mother Earth and get grounded. There's a lot of ways to do it if you don't have direct access to it on certain days to do it, but still really have that intent to get grounded. And oh, goodness sake. So I lost my train of thought. I went off on a tangent.
You said so many important things before. Let's go to one of the reasons that despite technology is getting so much better, I'm using air quotes, in the 10 or so years that all these smartphones have been out, battery life is still terrible, but it's not because they're bad at making batteries hold more energy, right? It's actually for another reason.
It's for the data harvesting. Yeah. The reason our shelf life of our batteries go so quickly is because these apps are harvesting your information at record speeds. I bought a new Android phone and had it retrofitted, so there's no parts from CCP, and I don't have a lot of apps on it that are tracing. My battery will last for days with this phone, up to 10 days on one charge. It's unbelievable. Wow. But when you have these other phones, they're pulling information off you 24/7. And literally on my new phone, I could take my SIM card out, use wireless, use Signal as an app, double encrypted. I literally can be invisible and have conversations with anyone around the world just connecting through Wi-Fi and go wherever I need to go. So we don't need all this stuff, but there's definitely awarenesses of how to get it. So going back to my train of thought, I wanted to go into the cognitive challenges of EMF and the list of challenges. So I mentioned Martin Paul and Klinghardt and bioinitiative.org with the studies with all these scientists. I mentioned the work of Arthur Furstenberg on his work, which is profound. Now, what we found is there's, in my world with the grounding bags, and I have EMF Rocks is my company where we hand mine crystals that have moisture magnetic properties. So it's a Schumann resonance in a bag. What we found is people's eyes, their teeth, their thymus, and their small intestine are areas that get decharged from EMF. Those are the most sensitive areas of the body. So we can use our grounding bags, and we'll go over that a little later, to recharge the body. But once those areas are decharged, what I feel, there becomes a gateway for level 1, 2, and 3 EMF. And level 1 would be all cognitive, Abel. So focus, memory, anxiety, behavioral, stress, headaches, those would be all cognitive challenge, like that brain fog feeling when you have crappy intake. It's the same as a brain fog feeling from being inundated with excess EMF. It's a cognitive challenge. And then the level 2 would be more severe headaches, ringing in the ears, muscle twitches, bloody noses. When they use the millimeter waves as weapons, as they did in the Havana cohort, or exposed it in that Havana cohort, which was the first attack of U.S. embassy workers on foreign soil with microwave radiation, that was non-trauma concussion symptoms. And that's what they said. So nausea, vomiting. So that's a level 2. And then the skin, rashes on the skin, that's level 2 of the EMF challenges. And then we go into the level 3, which is the bigs. Cancer, suicide, diabetes, Alzheimer's, suicide, and then what we mentioned previously is the lack of fertility. So that's where we know we're going. And when there's California's Department of Public Health has hit studies, childrenshealthdefense.org, the Robert Kennedy Jr.'s Foundation is suing the FCC for throwing up satellites and the levels that they're rolling out. And they did, they won, they got a court initiative that the FCC, they have to go back and relook at those levels because the information that they presented was overwhelming. And this stuff isn't rocket science. This stuff is in waves per second. And when we can understand physics and biology, we'll be able to get past this stuff really quickly.
Yeah, but at first, we need to at least be able to talk about it, right? And so that's also a major challenge these days. How have you seen in your time kind of working with athletes and in the world of athleticism, how have you seen the landscape of health and conversations change, and where do you think they're going in the next few years, or how can we make it better?
That's awesome. Well, one of the reasons I got into this space is I saw the athletes breaking down. And I personally felt, I do lots of muscle testing, applied kinesiology. I'm one of those facilitators that have some really innate gifts that I've been blessed with. So I can feel energy and read it and have intuition that I've really cultivated through my career working with these hotshot athletes. And what I saw is I foresaw a lot of trends. I go over it in my book. My wife will tout all about it. We had the first BOSU ball in a gym with David Weck coming in. Steve Cotter, a kettlebell guy, was in that gym with us training, and he has IKFF kettlebell, one of the first guys to bring kettlebells in it. I am in my 50s now and was gluten-free, found out I was gluten-free at age 18 and found out. So I was one of the first guys to eat sandwiches and peel like a banana. And everyone's like, why are you eating the bread? And so I've seen a lot of these trends, and now it's going into breath work and meditation and all that. Saw that coming. Well, this EMF trend, I also saw coming and got into the space about a decade ago because I could feel that energy really well. And I started to see guys using the wearable technology. The strongest, fittest guys, endurance athletes, would come in wearing a smartwatch. Their whole arm was weak. And they're like, Justin, my arm's weak. What do I do? I'm like, let's start with losing the radiation on your wrist, because we look at the factors that are stressors. So what are the stressors on the body? It can be physical, which is too much exercise, too little, or a big trauma. It could be mental, emotional, thoughts, feelings, emotions, stress, right? That will downregulate your nervous system. And then it could be biochemical. So it could be food, drink, air. And the one that we hadn't looked at any substantial level back then was EMF. And that's where I'm like, aha, the EMF is that invisible stressor. And that's why I got into this, because clinically I saw my clients breaking down from it.
And did you see it happen quickly, or kind of like one arm at a time, you know, just like one electric car at a time, or was it kind of a rapid downfall for a lot of these guys and gals?
I think it's more of a slow cook process, and that's where we're being challenged with it, is we don't understand these levels. A lot of people may not feel them right away, or they're like, oh, I feel a tingling, and they just ignore it. And it's more of a slow cook process, and that's where, when they keep adding and adding and adding these millimeter waves, you know, our bodies are adapting. We're looking at waveform technology, Abel. This is huge, huge for everyone to understand, because everything has a resonance, everything has a frequency. And when we can understand that, some can be disruptive for us, whether it's cosmic or man-made, that's okay. Our bodies are just gonna do what they need to do. So let's start listening to Abel's, you know, intake protocol. Let's start getting grounded by nature. Okay. Let's start adding some incredible products to our home and our space and our car and our bed to keep us grounded by nature when we're not outside getting grounded by nature.
Totally. I this has been such a fun conversation, Justin. What's the best place for people to find EMF Rocks, you, your work, and why don't you riff on that for just a little?
Oh, thanks. So athleticism.com, it's spelled athletic, ism.com is where we sell curated health and performance products. And then emfrocks.com is where we sell our Faraday bags and then grounding bags and mini grounding bags for your pocket, purse, or backpack. So that's where they can find us. And I'm really outspoken on waveform resonances and understanding biology and physics. And not many people have been taught that. And that's what we need. And one of the blessings of the last couple of years is we've started to understand more about health and nutrition and what makes it and what doesn't make it. And I'm so grateful to be around this time and have that voice to really go even another step and go, hey, everything is a resonance and a frequency. So thank you so much, Abel, for allowing me to share this.
Absolutely. We need you. Everything is a resonance and a frequency. I wouldn't be a musician if that weren't true. We can use it for good. You know, it's not all bad. There's a lot to look forward to, and we can make this better. So I really appreciate you as well, Justin, coming on the show and talking about this. So thanks again for coming on. Really appreciate you.
Thank you, Abel.
Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about, friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge, coaching group, or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Woo! Okay. Don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate nut cookies, as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening and have a great week.